Hi, everybody. It's Gene Simmons, and you're not, and you're listening to the Potter Than Hell podcast with Steve, BC, BB, and Dylan. But you knew that, didn't you?
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Potter Than Hell podcast. This is your last stop on the crazy train of hard rock and heavy metal. So sit back, buckle in, and hang on. Here we go.
Hello, Potter Than Hellions, and welcome back to the Potter Than Hell podcast. I'm your host for this evening, Dylan, and I am joined this week by
BB.
And the Big S, the Podfessor, as well as BC, are on the high BCs, and the Monsters of Rock cruise left us on the dry land. It's the song I'm on a boat all over again.
Yes, somebody had to hold down the fort here, you know.
Yep.
And they picked the two best guys to hold the fort down. You know, they can go out and do their sailing and meet all those guys and have a ball, and we'll just hang back here and work like the dogs that we are, Dylan, and just...
I'm the only one that never gets a break on this podcast, damn it.
God damn it, Dylan needs a vacation, Steve.
I need a vacation from this vacation. No, but we hope they're having a good time. It seems like they are with all the pictures that are popping up. Now, you have who their list they were, like, was playing today, right? Did you see anybody good?
The list I have so far that they actually seen, 2 minutes ago, Steve was just live. They were watching Winger. Winger's a great band. They always put on a great show. But some of the other people they've already seen, Tesla, Michael Schenker, Burning Witches, which I would have loved to see because, you know, we missed them at M3 that time.
Mm-hmm.
And now Courtney Cox plays with them. And not the friends Courtney Cox, so Courtney Cox from the Iron Maidens.
Yeah.
They met Danny Vaughn, the lead singer of Taiketto. I don't know if they saw them sing yet. I don't know. They've seen Vane, Queensryche, Stephen Piercy, Jeff Scott Soto solo, and Soto and Beeler together. Mm-hmm. So, you know, so far it seems like they're having a ball. Sonny finally paid up for losing a bet. He had to wear a Saxon shirt.
Yep. That's a wonderful post on the Growing Up Rock podcast page. I was laughing very hard at that.
Yeah, it just looks like they're having a great time, and maybe one of these years we'll get on there.
Yeah, maybe.
Then we'll have to record from the room. You know?
It's a lot of money, and I already spent most of my money on Taylor Swift tickets, so I don't know if I'll be able to afford it. And we got that coming up this week. Very excited. You'll be in the parking lot, Jan.
Yeah, I'll probably be in the parking lot. My wife keeps saying, just get a ticket. And, you know, I'm like, I'll save the $500 and just stand there because I'm sure I'll hear it.
Yeah.
But they're all psyched up. They're showing me videos of this and that. But let me tell you, she puts on an amazing show from, you know, the little things I've seen. You know, in a way, I'm going to be a little jealous, I think, just for the showmanship that she has for her fans. It's amazing.
Yeah, it was a really great show. It was a long show, 3.5 hours, and I thought it was paced very well, too. Mm. Like, there were the slow parts when it was needed, the pickups happened. I would have changed the set list a little bit, but that's just me. Guitar solos as well.
Right.
We got some guitar solos, but the stage setup is really fantastic. So I think Randy and Casey are going to have a great time on Friday, and then I'll be there Sunday for the Mother's Day show.
Nice.
Instead of celebrating with Corey, and I feel very bad about that.
Now, but, do she switches up a couple songs in the middle?
She has,
Is that like the acoustic part or something?
She has a surprise acoustic, they're like the surprise acoustic songs that she'll do like in the middle where she'll change them. She originally started where she's doing a different song, like two different songs each time, but some of the songs she screwed up, so she's like, well, I'm giving myself permission to do them again to make them better. The show that I saw, they were like two songs from, one of them was from Speak Now and the other one was from Red. So, and usually during those songs are when she has the special guest appear.
Oh, okay.
Of course, we were the one show that didn't have the special guest because he was in the audience watching the show. But, you know, it could happen. Phoebe Bridgers could be joining her on stage because she's opening for the Philly show, and that's what I'm most excited about.
Yes, that's what Casey said as well. She said that they have really good openers.
Yes, so. And Phoebe Bridgers appeared on the Blacklist Metallica cover thing. She did Nothing Else Matters.
Right.
And speaking of Metallica, BB, the first shows of the M72 World Tour happened since we've been podcasting. The first no-repeat weekend. Some cool songs that featured in some of our set lists. They did Leopard Messiah. That's what I'm most excited about.
Dylan's happy about that one.
But it looks like each set list is pretty diverse. Like, you get Master of Puppets one night and Enter Sandman another. So it's, you know, splitting the hits a little bit. A couple of live debut of the new songs. But, you know, 16 song sets on each night. And they did Whiskey in a Jar, so.
See? There you go. That was on my list, and it's kind of, it's a fan favorite in a way, but, you know, some fans hate it. You know, I'm like, it's a great tempo song. It's a great stadium song.
Absolutely.
You know, so I'm glad they threw that in there. Yeah, I saw a couple set lists, and I was impressed. That, you know, kudos to those guys for thinking this up, and I'm still wondering what the middle day they do.
You know? Yeah, I didn't see anything. I didn't see anything. About that.
Yeah, so.
So I don't know if they're keeping it hush hush or they didn't do anything. I don't know, but or I wasn't looking hard enough. That could have been too. But any other news before we get into?
Not that I think. You know, off the top of my head, it's kind of been quiet in the music world. Mm-hmm. I don't even know if there's even, like, big releases. Mike Trapp has something from the White Lion years that's, like, an acoustic album.
Yeah, Mike Trapp plays White Lion, I believe it was called.
Other than that, nothing's jumping out at, like, hey, there's a great release, you know. Yeah. But it's been kind of, like, music quiet.
Yeah. I mean,
which
hey.
Which is a good thing.
Sometimes it's good to catch up on stuff. And speaking of which, what have you been listening to this week? Any catching up on new stuff or old stuff?
A little bit of both. I'm still digging, you know, like we kind of already touched on, I'm still digging that new Metallica. I'm loving the new three songs that have been released from Extreme.
Mm.
They're three great songs. And then I was doing some work in the kitchen the other day, and I just said to Alexa to play Mr. Big.
There you go.
For like 3 hours, she rambled on pretty much, I think, almost every song from Mr. Big. So that's what I've been jamming out. How about you?
Awesome. Yeah, I've also been listening to 72 Seasons. I really do like the album. Like I said in one of the other episodes, James was sounding a little hoarse, a little raspy at times, but I think it's a very good album that's going to grow on me. I was also listening to a little bit of Shout Out the Devil. I don't know. Just kind of the mood struck me, so I decided to listen to that. But I really haven't had too much time to delve into a lot of things. Work's been having me coming and going, so that's kind of been all I've been hitting. But, I mean, hey, these are good stuff to listen to. Mr. Big, Extreme, and Metallica for BB, and Metallica, and Shout Out the Devil for Motley Crue for myself. Last week's episode, I believe this is coming out after BC's birthday episode, according to the schedule that the Big S has given me. So hopefully we have survived listening to those albums. We have not recorded that yet. Who knows with BC? He usually pulls out some diamonds in the rough, though.
Yes. At least one. Yes. At least one out of the four.
Yes. So I'm very excited to get into those when we do. But that's for the future for us, past for you all listening. And right now we're going to be talking about Foo Fighters. This is our usual jaunt whenever it's the two of us alone together. Last time, the episode was 199, the best of Foo Fighters, where we covered basically up until Echo, Silence, Patience, and Grace. And then the episode before that was 136, Learn to Fly with the Foo Fighters, where we covered the first couple albums. We're going to be covering basically up until recent times. As we speak, their latest album, But Here We Are, has not come out yet, but they did release a first single that BB, actually, you brought to my attention. Yeah. I did not know about it until you texted me. Have you listened to that? What did you think
of
it?
I think it's in the vein of the last couple albums. Mm-hmm. Like, I always admire how they kind of do their own thing.
Yeah.
Like, they're not out there to please everybody in a way. I think what the band feels, that's what they're going to do, that's what they're going to release.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's pretty much in the vein of their last album, Medicine at Midnight. It's not very upbeat like the early Foo stuff, but it's still in that main stream of what they have released the last couple of years.
Yeah.
You know, very short solo, but of course, you know, Dave Grohl's Vocals are fantastic, and I'm just very curious because I have not found anything. I thought I heard a name, but I'm wondering who's actually doing the drumming.
Yes, that has been the big speculation across the way about who has drummed on the album and who will be drumming going on the tour with them, because they are touring to promote this album. So everybody's throwing out a bunch of names. I know Matt Cameron from Pearl Jam and Soundgarden has been thrown out a couple times. The drummer from The Darkness, I heard. Mm. A couple of other people, Josh Fries, I think, was another name that was thrown out. But it's very, I think it's a good lead single.
Yeah.
I think it's a better lead single than the one from Medicine at Midnight, which we will get into. hate that song. But you'll have to wait to find out what song that is, unless you know specifically.
I believe the song is called is it Rescued?
Yeah, Rescued, yes. Rescued. Very kind of hopeful feeling song. Yeah. The lyrics are very kind of soaring in a way, but I did enjoy it very much. I thought it was a good indicator for what this album is going to be. But before we can get to that album, we have to kind of go back to the past. So Echoes, Silence, Patience, and Greats came out, and it got a lot of pretty good acclaim. Won a couple Grammys. Of course, The Pretender blew up. And at that time, the old guitarist Pat Smear was seen with the band a couple times, and ended up rejoining the band. So then they had three guitarists, you know, Dave, Chris, and Pat. And they ended up recording Wasting Light, which we had recovered in a previous episode. I believe it was one of my birthday albums. But that was an album that they recorded in Dave's garage, back to basics, Butch Vig producing. They recorded on tape. It's my favorite Foo Fighters album. It's so good. And that came out and had a lot of clout. There was five Grammys that album won. It was nominated for six. And at that time, they had also recorded a documentary called Back and Forth, which, if you haven't seen that, that is such a good documentary from the band. Everybody gets interviewed, even the old band members. You know, it's a really cool introspection into the band up until that period. And they really kind of open up about the tension and the problems that they had at times. And it's really, really interesting and revealing. And it also kind of goes into the recording of Wasting Light as well, which was really, really cool. But once Wasting Light came out, they kind of headlined a bunch of different shows that were like two sold-out shows at the Milton Keynes National Bowl. They headlined Lollapalooza. They trolled the Westboro Baptist Church. They had a really great couple of shows before they kind of went on hiatus from, 2011 to 2013 to record their next album. And this album is very interesting because Sonic Highways, which was the next album that was recorded, was not recorded in a traditional way where you go into the studio, you have the producer, you write the songs, stuff like that. Instead, they went across the country, across the USA, to eight different cities and wrote and recorded a song in each of the cities. Of course, Butch Vig came back to help produce, and they also came up with a docuseries on HBO called Sonic Highways, where they showcased the history of the music in those cities and the recording of the album and stuff like that. But it ended up having, you know, eight different locations. Chicago, Illinois, Arlington County, Virginia, Nashville, Tennessee, Austin, Texas, Joshua Tree, California, New Orleans, Louisiana, Seattle, Washington, and then New York City, New York. So those were the eight locations that they picked. And they also included a lot of musicians from those areas to come in, help write or record on the album. And it comes out in a very interesting sound. It's 42 minutes long. It was released November 10, 2014, recorded from September of 2013 to July of 2014, of course, because they were going across the country to do it. But I think the first thing that I want to ask is, BB, what did you think of this album? Had you heard it before this episode? And what did you think of it listening to it?
I've only probably heard a couple songs off this album. I've never listened to this album front to back. When I listened to it, it seemed like it's very, I want to say all over the place in a way.
Yeah.
But I understand the way it's all over the place, because you have to understand they traveled. They like the first song that they do in Chicago, mm-hmm, with Rick Nielsen from, yep, Cheap Trick, you know, and then they have guys from like a jazz band, you know. So, like I said before, they do what they want, mm-hmm. you know what I mean. And even though this album is all over the place, for the people that they have on the album, it works fantastic in my ear.
Yeah,
I think this is a really, really good album. It's very odd to travel to 8 different places just to record one song.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
Yeah, for sure. If the documentary also wasn't a thing, I would be like, that's a bit much.
Right.
But because the documentary, they kind of go through the history of music in those cities and kind of how different genres of music developed and kind of really wanted to showcase the history of just music in America.
Okay,
I think
right.
that's a really cool concept for a record. It's pretty extra. It's a lot, but... I think eclectic is definitely the word that I would use. It's one of those situations where I think if you didn't know the concept, you would think that this record was like completely all over the place. Yeah. The songs don't really fit together. But isn't that the United States of America,
sure.
BB? Isn't that how the U.S. of A is?
It's the Foo Fighters. They do what they want.
Exactly. Let's go track by track. Open it up with Something From Nothing. Like you said, featuring Rick Nielsen from Cheap Trick. This is a fantastic opener. You have the kind of quiet, clean electric guitar opening with Dave's plaintive vocals, but then the rest of the band kicks in, and it kind of just builds as the song goes. And then at the end, you're going into this awesome jam section with blistering solos. It really just completely just bombasts into something crazy. And there's a lot of cool references inside the song, like... it started with a spark, which is a reference to the Great Chicago Fire. Wash it in the muddy water, you know, reference to muddy waters. So it's like there's a lot of really cool in jokes of sort inside the lyrics. What did you think of this song?
Yeah, I really enjoy this one. This is a great opener. This is definitely one of the top three songs of the night. There's even in the beginning, it even starts off like, it's almost like a Dio, like last in line. It kind of starts and then it stops. I'm like,
I didn't think that is very Holy Diver.
Holy Diver. Yeah. That's it.
Syncopation.
And I'm like, oh, like that sounds familiar. And I kind of listened to it. Then I had to look and see who was playing on it. I'm like, okay. I'm like, oh, but it is a cool little riff. But I love how I love throughout their discography how they like to start off songs slow and build it.
Yeah.
This starts off super slow and builds up like to Dave screaming vocals at the end.
It has the signature screaming vocals.
You know? And Taylor's big drum sound on this song. This is a great opening track for this album. Mm-hmm. But if you're looking for something like this opening track, you may be a little disappointed.
Yeah, this was the lead off single, and I think you couldn't have picked a better song to showcase this album.
For sure.
It really is a punch in the face of an opener. Then we go into the Feast and the Famine. This was recorded in Arlington County, Virginia, with Dave's old bandmates from Scream, Scream, the punk band, Peter Stahl and Skeeter Thompson. And Peter Stahl actually is the brother of Franz Stahl, who was in Scream as well, but also was in Foo Fighters for a little bit as the guitarist once Pat left. Feast of the Famine is another kind of heavy one that goes right in, and it does have that kind of punk feel to it. I do love the cadence of the chorus. The background vocals are fantastic in this. I love the anybody. It's a really great second song. What'd you think of this one?
Yeah, this has that iconic punkish / Foo Fighters sound that they pretty much grew up with. I love the band harmonies in this at the chorus, and the outro music is killer. It's almost a great 1-2 punch.
Yeah.
You know, if you will, for this album.
Yeah, Taylor's drum fills in the end of that song are just fantastic. He's rolling those drums like nothing else. It's great. Then we go into Congregation, recorded in Nashville, Tennessee, with Zach Brown from the Zach Brown Band, who has been known to rock a couple times. He's covered Enter Sandman live. But very much you can feel the country, southern feel in this one. You got that kind of church... Kentucky Fried sound to it a little bit. Again, great background vocals in this one. I think it's another cool one. It's a different change of pace, but still upbeat. I think that it is a good palate cleanser for how intense Feast and the Famine was. But I think it's a good track three. What'd you think?
Yeah, it's a nice little tempo change. Definitely the melody changes in this, the cool time changes. Even the ending. The ending has a little bit of meat and potatoes at the end. They go off a little bit extra there. But like I said, it works at number three for me. But it's a good song. You know, it's tough when you have that country feel, but you want the Foo Fighter feel to it.
Yeah. Yeah, it works to combine them, but after the heaviness of Something from Nothing and Feast and the Famine, it's definitely a different feel. Yeah. You're going in a different sense. And that different feel continues with track four, recorded in Austin, Texas, What Did I Do? / God Is My Witness, featuring the great Gary Clark Jr., fantastic guitarist. This one is a weird one. There's a lot of stop and start, a lot of kind of cacophony parts in this. I like the God Is My Witness part a little bit less than the, like, when the What Did I Do part picks up. This is a weird one. I wasn't expecting the different time changes and tempo changes. There's a lot going on in this song. It's kind of a lot, but it's not bad. What do you think?
Yeah, the piano in it really, the piano start on this one really kind of threw me off because I didn't really expect it, but it wasn't that bad. I really got like a really weird, like either like Wings or Paul McCartney or Beatles feel to it with that jaunty piano playing in the background.
Yeah, I can see that for sure. Jaunty piano brought to you by Rami Jaffe, who would join the band's next album, but is at this point just a session musician. Next song from Joshua Tree, California, Outside, featuring Joe Walsh from the Eagles and Chris Goss, I believe from like Caius. And maybe Eagles of Death Metal as well. But this one, very straightforward rocker. It does have that kind of Eagles flair to it from Joe Walsh. There's the part towards the middle that the bass is kind of just riding, and then the guitar kind of sparsely picking in the background. A cool little... It does remind me of the desert. This is a very desert song for me. What'd you think of it?
It's funny when you... I have this almost the same exact notes with this one. Straightforward Foo Fighter rocker. You know, it's nothing fancy. But that there's like you said, that cool, funky, soft drum, little plucking guitar part at the solo is really neat and different for the Foo Fighter sound.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that Joe Walsh is used well in this part. I'm surprised that they got him on a lucid day because he is burnt out like nothing else.
Yes.
But next song from Nolens, Louisiana. In the Clear, featuring the Preservation Hall Jazz Band. Very famous band that plays in New Orleans. You know, they frequent Preservation Hall, of course, as their name implies. This one was interesting. I thought that it was good. Not what I expect from a Foo Fighters album. What did you think?
Yeah, these next two, between the Outside and In the Clear, the horns are all right. You know, it's different. It really shakes up the album. But it's just nothing that you expect.
Yeah.
Or, you know, sometimes you want to hear that punch of, you know, Dave's screaming vocals or Taylor's big drums. And this song, two things are not in it. And like I said, the horns are another surprise for me.
Mm-hmm.
But you understand, you know, what they're doing, where they're going, who they're playing with. You know, that's, you know, it's understandable.
Yeah.
You know, for how this album is working.
Mm-hmm. And then we're on track seven, recorded in Seattle, Washington, a part that's near and dear, of course, to Dave's heart, besides Virginia, because, you know, that's Nirvana's stomping grounds. Subterranean, featuring Ben Gibbard from Death Cab for Cutie. Strange person to include on this one, because Death Cab for Cutie is a very indie band, but this one's very low-key at the beginning. Kind of, you get the soft Dave vocals for it. There are some cool different parts in the middle of the song, but it kind of a song that for me overstays its welcome a little bit. What'd you think?
Yeah, when I saw where this was recorded, this was one of the ones I really was. Ooh, this is gonna be like old school Nirvana sound.
Yeah,
you know,
not
where their foundation is, And then when I heard it, I'm like, meh. I'm like, what a silly mid-tempo song to be recorded in Seattle.
Yeah.
Yeah, this was the disappointment for me on this one. I expected too much, I think.
Yeah, I definitely understand. You do see Seattle, and you're like, grunge, Dave Grohl. Pat Smear was even part of the grunge thing. Like, you would think that would be, and then it's very like
super mellow, mid-tempo, no big drums.
Taking inspiration from the rain instead of the, you know, yeah. The storm.
Yeah, they're playing in the coffee shops.
Yeah, yeah, it's the end of Rockstar, not the beginning. And then track 8, the last track recorded in New York City, New York, I Am a River, featuring the legendary Tony Visconti, who wrote a lot of great songs, especially with David Bowie. You know, a very cool guy. And Christine Young, who has apparently done a lot of songs with a bunch of different artists as well. I Am a River. I don't know if I would have ended the album with this one. It's kind of it's one that it's long. It's 7 minutes long. I don't go to the Foo Fighters for long songs. It's good, though. I think it was fine, but I just... The back half of this album, for me, cannot match the potential of the front half. What do you think?
Yeah, I agree with that statement 100%. This was almost like Subterranean. It kind of had just like a mainly mid-tempo for these guys. You know, nothing fancy. The big musical ending was a relief, because at least it kind of ended in a bang.
Mm-hmm.
But this 1-2 punch at the ending was not what I expected, or, you know, pretty much not what I go to, you know, when you talk about the Foo Fighters.
Yeah. Yeah, it was... This album, for me, I've always been kind of up and down on, because I love the first 5 songs a lot. Like, they are go-to Foo Fighters songs for me. But then the last songs are so forgettable,
mm-hmm.
in my mind. Not that every song has to be a winner, and, you know, sometimes different music styles don't vibe with you. And if you're going across the United States getting inspiration from different cities, of course you're going to have different sounding songs. So not everything's going to be, you know, up there for you. But I think that it was a cool idea. Sonic Highways, I actually believe, won Emmys for the documentary, which is really cool.
I'll have to check that out. I looked for it today and I saw bits and pieces. I didn't see the whole thing.
Yeah, it's very hard to find online nowadays, which is weird, because it's such a good series that, you know, you think that would be readily available. You think that it would be streaming on HBO since it was made for HBO, but HBO has been dropping the ball for me in many aspects, and this is just one of them.
This is just one of many.
Oh, sorry, Max. They're now called Max. Oh. Sorry. Anyways, yeah, so Sonic Highways came out. And they went on the Sonic Highways World Tour, going on their own Sonic Highways, such as it was. And actually, during the tour, they decided to take a little break on May 20th to be the very last band to play the late show with David Letterman. Because David Letterman, very big Foo Fighters fan, he was the one who had them on TV for the first time. And the Foo Fighters were the ones to play him out of his late night career.
I don't think I knew that.
Yeah, they played Everlong. Which a very famous song for David Letterman, I guess. It really meant a lot to him after his open heart surgery. So it was kind of a really cool send off for David Letterman. And then on June 12th, during the Sonic Highways World Tour in Gothenburg, Sweden, Dave Grohl took a tumble, fell off the stage during the second song. He got medical attention and he ended up finishing the show. And his leg was super broken. And literally he was on the stage, his foot was in the chair, and the medic was like making sure the leg was fine while they played the end of the show. So he had to get flown to London for surgery. He had 6 metal pins put in his leg, and they canceled the remaining European tour dates. However, they restarted the show, the North American tour, which was co-dubbed the Broken Leg Tour. And in fact, this is where I saw Foo Fighters live. I have the set list right here for the Sonic Highways World Tour. It was July 16th, 2015. And I got 2 shirts. It was at Citi Field in New York. There was one shirt that had the Break a Leg Tour, and it had him in the cast. And the other shirt was made to look like a Mets jersey that was made specifically for the show. And the shirts were $20.
That's it?
The shirts were $20.
Jesus.
It was a general admission show, and the shirts were $20, BB. Foo Fighters, yeah, one of the biggest bands ever. $20 shirts. That's how you need to do it, people.
Yeah, for sure. Holy cow. Yeah. I don't think I've seen $20 shirts since 1982.
That's what I'm saying. I was like, I was ready to break the bank to get a shirt. And then I saw they were $20. I'm like, buying two.
Yep.
But the show set list, they opened with Everlong. Then they go into Monkey Wrench, Learn to Fly, Something from Nothing, The Pretender, Big Me, Congregation, Walk, the song from, not the Pantera song, the song from Wasting Light. Then they did a cool medley where they did the first parts of Detroit Rock City, Jailbreak from Thin Lizzy, and School's Out from Alice Cooper when they were introducing the band. They would each kind of start part of the song, which was really cool. Then they did Cold Day in the Sun with Taylor Hawkins on lead vocals. Then they did an acoustic part of My Hero Times Like These. Then they did a cover of Under Pressure, which was really cool. Then All My Life, These Days, they did Outside. They did Breakout, which is a fantastic song. Dear Rosemary. They did an awesome cover of Breakdown from Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers. It was so good. Then they did White Limo, Arlandria. Then they brought Daryl, Jennifer, and Dr. No from the Bad Brains on stage, which my dad was so excited for. He was screaming his head off about the Bad Brains. Now he hated it. And they did the Bad Brains songs, How Low Can a Punk Get, and The Regulator. And then they ended the show with This Is a Call and Best of You. The Royal Blood as an opener. It was one of the best shows I've ever seen in my life.
I cannot believe that was 8 years ago.
I know. 2015. I feel very old. And Chad Smith was the guest on the other show that they played at Citi Field. So I'll leave it up to you to decide who came out on top. But my dad was not happy about the Bad Brains. But that tour, he had the guitar throne.
Well, that's right.
And that he would play on for the tour. And he had more stage presence on that guitar throne than a lot of other people that I've seen. And, of course, Axl Rose would borrow that throne for... I believe when he was with AC/DC, when he broke his leg, that was lent out to him from Dave Grohl, showing how much of a consummate professional he is. But then during the tour, they ended up surprise releasing an EP dedicated to the victims of the terrorist attack in Paris that happened, because it was during an Eagles of Death Metal show that happened at. And Dave is a really big, is good friends with Josh Homme and them, I think that was the one. Yes, it was. There was a group of suicide bombers, and then there was a mass shooting at the concert.
Oh, okay.
And that was like a horrible event that happened. And of course, they tributed Saint Cecilia to the victims of that show. What did you think of this EP? I know I sprung this on you last minute, but it's a quick 5-song EP, 18 minutes long. I'm very interested to hear your thoughts.
I absolutely love this little EP. This is pretty much a lot of the sound that I kind of go to the Foo Fighters for. Except for the ending song, the Never Ending Sigh. That was a little bit of a slower kind of song that I didn't thrill me. But the first three songs, the three out of the five, Saint Cecilia, Sean, and...
Save Your Breath.
That Save Your Breath, if you're looking for at least a 12-second solo, that's like the Sick Banana short solo of their catalog. So I'm like, whoa!
Yeah.
You know, and it's there, and it's there, and it's gone. You know, but yeah, this was great. This is a great little gem that I didn't hear of. And I don't know how I missed this one, but this is a great little EP. Do you enjoy this one as much as I did?
I do. This is the Foo Fighters that I enjoy the most when they're at this rocking, when they're just jamming.
Yeah.
And this EP is just full of Foo Fighter jams. I love this EP so much. Saint Cecilia, Sean, and Save Your Breath are songs that should be more well known for Foo Fighters, and they're kick ass. They're so good. And what I was missing from the last songs of Sonic Highways, I got with this. And when this came out, I was like, "Yes, okay, we're going to Rockin' Foos again." I'm very excited. Not quite what happens in the next couple albums, but the fact that this EP came out to kind of ride the tide over in case you weren't really digging some of the stuff from Sonic Highways, I think it's a really fantastic quick five-song EP. Yeah, Iron Rooster and Neverending Sigh aren't up to the par of the other three songs, right. But those three songs are just kick-ass.
Once again, it's a very heavy front.
It's a very heavy front, yeah. They front-load their albums, BB. Yeah, I don't know what it is. They need to... They burn out too quick, I guess.
Yeah, I wonder if you would feel different from the first, about the last two songs, mm-hmm. if they were maybe like at 2 and 4.
And, yeah.
You know, if it mixes a little bit better, you put the heaviers at like 1, 3, and 5.
Yeah, put Save Your Breath like, and End That.
I wonder how that would actually sound instead of putting the two slower, middle tempo ones, you know, at the end when you're like, you're so hyped up from the first three. Mm-hmm. And they're like, what happened here?
Yeah,
the wheels fell off.
That's a good point. I definitely think it would help with the mixing of the album. And like, this is at the point where streaming has become very prevalent. So it's really just like, we know you're going to listen to the first three songs. So here's the good stuff. And if you care enough to listen past that, here's the two other ones.
Right, exactly.
but I really wanted to talk about this one because I think this is some of their very hidden
gems. Yeah, for sure.
And speaking of hidden gems, I think it's high time for us to do our gem song. And you know what? I'm going to have the gem song be Save Your Breath from the St. Cecilia EP. So we'll be back with our hidden gems after we listen to Save Your Breath from St. Cecilia Foo Fighters. Was Foo Fighters with Save Your Breath from St. Cecilia, a hidden gem if ever there was one. And we're going to go into our hidden gems. BB, what do you got for us
all
this
right,
week?
All right, we're gonna go back all the way to 1982. These guys are from out of Australia. The band is called Heaven, with the album title Twilight of Mischief. This is very early, heavy rock, if you will. This is like AC/DC's little cousin. But this is some great stuff. In their later albums, actually, Ozzy Osbourne and I think Lita Ford on different songs play background vocals. So I'm sure BC and your father have probably albums of these guys, have the vinyl over there in the shelf. But this is this band I kind of fell across a couple weeks ago. But yeah, so definitely check this out. Really good stuff. Band is Heaven, and the album is called Twilight of Mischief.
Very cool. It is a B-side, but my hidden gem is from one of the releases that Foo Fighters had from they released a bunch of different EPs called the Foo Files, where they had different B-sides and live releases that they placed in different sections of their catalog. And this one comes from the EP 01050525. Or the B-sides from In Your Honor, which was the half acoustic, half electric album that we covered. And it's a cover of Creedence Clearwater Revival's Born on the Bayou. Dave's vocals, perfect for that song, of course, hitting that John Fogerty like grit. The solos in it are done very well. It's a very cool cover that I had not heard till very recently. So check it out. They do covers very well. A lot of them were on Medium Rare, which was a kind of a B-sides covers album that they released, including Have a Cigar from Pink Floyd, sung by Taylor Hawkins. But those are our hidden gems. BB's got Heaven, Twilight of Mischief, and I have Foo Fighters covering Born on the Bayou.
Nice.
So, after Saint Cecilia was released, there was rumors that the Foo Fighters were going to break up. They released a mockumentary where they had Dave leave the band to pursue electronic music, and they had Nick Lachey replace him as lead singer. Of course, that did not happen. Instead, they decided to record another album, this time bringing in Rami Jaffe, like I said, as a full-fledged member. He had previously played keyboards with them live and in the studio, but they were just like, hey,
come on,
you're a member now, you're in the band. Of course, he was fantastic in the Studio 666 movie, spoiler alert, getting killed to a Jackal song.
That's right.
In a very violent manner. The Lumberjack song. Yeah, fantastic. But the next album that they released was called Concrete and Gold. It was released on September 15th, 2017. The first album to be produced with Greg Kurstin. No Butch Vig this time. He's out. This is an album that was recorded from December 2016 through May of 2017. They're not world hopping. They just recorded in Los Angeles this time. 48-minute runtime. And some of the people involved on this album. So from the other albums, of course, you have Dave Grohl, Chris Shiflett, Pat Smear, Nate Mendel, Taylor Hawkins, and Rami Jaffe. But you have Greg Kurstin coming in, Taylor Greenwood. You have Justin Timberlake on background vocals on one of the songs. You have Paul McCartney playing drums on one of the songs. And you have Sean Stockman from Boys to Men doing background vocals. And, of course, Boys to Men known for their harmonies. So
yes.
Who are you going to get to do background vocals? Boys to Men, ABC, BBD.
Yeah, you know me. Nice.
This album is very weird for me. I actually wrote a review of this back in college for the Woodward, where I have the same thoughts as I do now, where it's like you could hear the influences of their influences on this album. You could hear Beatles, you could hear Led Zeppelin, you know, Pink Floydish stuff. And it's a weird album. It has some good songs on it. It's all over the place. If you thought Sonic Highways was all over the place, this one is even more all over the place. It's a hard album to talk about because there's so much going on this album. I mean, you have what my dad's favorite thing, an intro track t-shirt. You know, starts off with like the low Dave vocals, and then it kind of has a little bit of a kick in. It's only a minute 22. What did you think as the intro to the album?
Yeah, this is a very oddball to start the album off, especially at a minute 14. It has that silly slow start, but it has a huge kick in. And then the ending is very like groovish. It's a different sound. So after you hear that, you're like, boy, where is this gonna go?
It almost feels like they were trying to redo Doll from The Color and the Shape, where it's like that like soft intro, then the hard like ending, and that's like the intro track, and then it goes into Monkey Wrench, and then this goes into Run, which was the lead off single. This is a very good song, very heavy. You get the Dave soft vocals and the screaming vocals. I think that this is probably one of the best tracks on the album, and it was, again, a very good choice for the lead-off single. What did you think?
Yeah, love this song. This is a killer song. Super heavy, super fast, you know, for the Foo Fighters. I love, you know, as much as we like to poke fun at the Cookie Monster, I love the Grohl growl, I'm going to call it.
The Grohl growl. Love it.
In some of these parts of this song, but this is a fantastic song. This is definitely the highlight of the album, mm-hmm. for sure.
Which is not a good thing when it's track two.
Yeah.
Number three, Make It Right. This is the song that has Justin Timberlake with the background vocals. I did not hear him at all. And Justin Timberlake has very pronounced vocals, so I don't know if they buried him in the mix or I wasn't paying attention too much. This was okay. I didn't mind it. What'd you think of this one?
Yeah, this was like a roller coaster of time changes.
Yeah.
There's some really cool guitar tones in this one. Once again, Taylor's big drums. Like, there's parts of this song that are like, wow, he's really beating the shit out of these drums. And I love when they do that crazy abrupt ending.
Yeah.
It's like, well, boom, and they're done.
Mm-hmm.
I instead of like just fading out. I love how they throw abrupt endings in here every once in a while.
Yeah, I agree. Track four, The Sky is a Neighborhood. Second single off this album. This was one that, while it's not Foo Fighters that I go to, the style that I go to for them, I don't mind it. I love how the guitar is in the background of the chorus, and I do love the background vocals in this. It's definitely a very politically charged song. I think it has a good groove to it. It's just very cool to hear Dave's vocals so isolated for most of the song, like during the verses. What'd you think of this
one? Yeah, I thought parts of his vocals, he almost sounds like he's singing in a hallway.
Yeah, parts. Very like echoed.
Yeah, like is he in a bathroom?
The sky.
But the band vocals at the chorus are so good.
Yeah.
You know, many stops and starts like that are iconic throughout their library of music. I think it worked. It worked for me. It wasn't as bad as the vocal sounded, because at parts it really, I thought they were all right, but then there were other parts like I just didn't know why the sound was just a different tone from his normal vocal range.
The production on this album as a whole, I think, is very strange. For one, it came in lower on the mix than everything else for me. I don't know if that was what I was listening to through Spotify, and that was a Spotify thing, but it felt like this album wasn't as production and mixing as crisp as the album before it, and even the album after it, I would say. And I don't know if this is, you know, a problem with Greg Kurstin, or if I'm just spoiled for Butch Vig, who, of course, is such a great producer, did Nevermind. I don't know. But La-Di-Da, this is a wild song. It's kind of crazy. It gets crazy. I don't know what the hell he's singing at parts, but I kind of liked it. It was a weird vibe, but a good one.
Yeah, it definitely gets heavier and faster as the song goes on. For some reason, I got a couple political undertones out of this one.
This is the one,
I think.
Dave is definitely having some frustrations with the political climate of this era during this album. And it's very evident. This whole album, for the most part, you can hear, like, I'm not happy with what's going on. And I'm like, Dave, I hear you, man, but that's not when I come to Foo Fighters.
Right, right.
Dirty Water, this is a different one for them as well. Again, like, it seems like everything's, like, going in different vibes with this album, and this is another one that, like, coming from La-Di-Da into this is a very different feeling.
It's a different song. For me, it still had that building thing to it. The harmonies were another thing that kind of stuck out for me with this one.
Yeah.
It had that building part, like I said, like they're known for. This one was all right for me. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't spectacular.
Mm-hmm. And then Arrows, that's another one that for me kind of, I didn't quite remember as well. It kind of got lost. This is a very long track list for me. I don't know, like a lot of these songs, because there's so much going on in them, they kind of wash over me.
Right.
What did you think of Arrows?
This must be where I get lost in this album, because as you see, I have the arrow. I don't have anything.
Yeah.
And then I go over here and I skip song 8.
Wow, you skipped song 8. Happily Ever After is song 8.
Oh, okay.
So,
I have it 9.
Okay.
Okay, so.
you just like, misnumbered.
What the hell? Arrows didn't, nothing.
Yeah, that's like, what I mean. Like, it was just like, it's there.
It's there, it's meh, it's kind of forgettable.
Yeah.
You know, nothing really stuck out.
Yeah. And then Happily Ever After is a full acoustic song. And I'm like, are we back to In Your Honor? Like, what's going on here?
Right.
It was nice, though. This is where
I knew that Paul McCartney played on this album.
Yeah.
And this song definitely felt like an earlier version of the Beatles, or an earlier version of his song from the Beatles, like Blackbird or something.
Mm-hmm.
It really felt like, oh, this must be where...
Yeah,
Paul McCartney plays, influence. And then I look down, I'm like, oh yeah,
nope,
that's not where he plays.
No, he plays on the next track, Sunday Rain. Taylor Hawkins lead vocals. For me, this is the hidden gem on the album.
Okay.
Because it's so different. Again, it's not what I come to Foo Fighters for at all. But it felt like a Beatles song to me.
Okay.
And I love Taylor's vocals on it. It has such it feels more finished than some of the other songs. I don't know why. But it's just like, I don't know if I'm just wistful for, you know, because Taylor passed away, and any chance I could have Taylor in the spotlight, I'm happy to see it, but I really like Sunday Rain.
Yeah, this is a good song. You can definitely tell, you know, you can tell Taylor's singing, and you can definitely tell that Paul McCartney is drumming,
mm-hmm.
because it's definitely not the bombastic that you're looking for, or even there are parts that almost didn't even sound like some of the beats kind of fit the song, and I was kind of confused by that, but it's a good song. I didn't mind it at all.
Mm-hmm. And then track 10, The Line, which was released as a single at track 10.
Hmm.
What do you think of that?
Oy,
that I don't think it should have been a single.
No, that's another one. That's like Arrows. I didn't write anything down for it.
This album has so many baffling things for me.
Yeah.
I'm like, why is that a single? Like, what about that was like, yes, we need to put that out on the radio. Everybody's going to love it.
Yeah.
I would have put Sunday Rain out before this. I would have put...
Definitely.
Dirty Water or La-Di-Da, Make It Right, you know, like...
What were the singles they actually released off this album?
It was Run, The Sky's a Neighborhood, and The Line, which the first two great choices.
Right.
But The Line, I don't know if I would.
Yeah. That must have been the producer talking or the record company. I don't think that was the band.
Yeah, I don't know. It was released a week in advance of the album, which that's gonna get everybody excited.
Dear Lord.
And then Concrete and Gold end off the thing. Again, I don't think it's a great closer. It's okay. I don't know. Maybe I'm just tired of the album at this point.
Yeah. This song for me had a very dark, like a very dark, very bass heavy feel to it. And,
yes.
And it was not the greatest closer, I didn't think, for, especially if you're, you know, going like the bookends with T-Shirt and Run.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this didn't fit the closing that you like, and just very, very dark.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, at this point in time, I was like, right before this album, I was at the height of my Foo Fighters fandom. You know, I had just seen them live. I was really excited about the direction they were going. And when I heard this album, I was very disappointed because it wasn't the hard-hitting Foos that I really go to. It was kind of all over the place, very Beatles, Led Zeppelin-inspired, weird stuff going on. I think I like the album a little more now that I see it for what it is, because I'm like, okay, I can go to Wasting Light or Saint Cecilia if I want really rockin' Foo, and I can go to this for weird Foo Fighters. But yeah, that was Concrete and Gold, kind of a bit of a dud after Saint Cecilia. Good stuff on it, but a little bloated for my marking. What did you think?
Yeah, it was kind of weird. Like, if you have 5 songs on the EP, you have 12 from Concrete and Gold, you could have put a really good album together, with some of these songs, cut some out. You probably have a good 10 album, a good 10 song album, and put it out like that and drop some of these Arrows and the Line and the Iron Rooster and the Never Ending Side. You can put a great album together, dropping some of these songs.
Yeah, absolutely. And then from Concrete and Cold, they went on tour again, and they went back into the studio October 2019. They ended the recording February of 2020, and then something happened. I don't know what happened, but it might have been a global pandemic caused by COVID-19. But they delayed releasing their next album for a good long while, a full year, in fact. They did not release the next album until February of 2021. Very disappointing for Dylan, who was like, oh, well, at least I have a new Foo Fighters album to look forward to now that everything's locked out. Wait, it's being delayed? Are you kidding me? and then, of course, it did come out February 20 of 2021. Medicine at Midnight, their 10th studio album, a brisk 36 minutes. A full 10 minutes less than Concrete and Gold. It was recorded in an unnamed house in Encino, Los Angeles. And they may have made a movie there as well called Studio 666, which BB and I covered during our Halloween special last year.
Yes.
Fantastic movie with a fantastic album to go along with it. This album, there was a lot of press release about the album. And Dave was saying, this album, we were very inspired by David Bowie's Let's Dance. And, of course, knowing me, I got really excited about that. But I also got really nervous because I'm like, okay, I love Let's Dance. That's one of my favorite albums of all time. You have Stevie Ray Vaughan on vocals. They're not vocals. On guitar for that album. I don't know if I like the Foos doing that. I like them more rocking than the dance rock of David Bowie. Especially seeing how Concrete and Gold came out. So I was little trepidatious about this one. I was a little like, okay, what's going to happen here? And then they released the first single, Shame Shame. And I'm like, oh God, I'm going to hate this fucking album. Shame Shame is the worst fucking Foo Fighters song of all time. It's a horrible opening song for a single. Why would you release that as a single? It has one mode. Shame. It's so lazy. Thankfully, they didn't open the album with it. They opened with Making a Fire. What did you think of that as an opener?
Yeah, the Making a Fire, it's upbeat. It's almost like poppy rock in a way. The female background singers are a nice little touch.
Yeah.
But, knowing this album, and I was... When I first listened to the whole album front to back when it came out, I'm like, it's always different when it's kind of like poppy and female background. You get a little nervous for this opening track.
This is definitely a trendsetter of a song. Like you said, the female background vocalist, that's a very prevalent thing through a lot of these songs. And you're like, this is not what I'm expecting from Foo Fighters. What is going to happen here? And it's very poppy. You're right. It's very poppy. You're like, okay, I'm waiting to see what happens. And then track 2 comes around, Shame Shame. And I'm just banging my head against the wall, like, why is this song on the album? What did you think of Shame Shame?
I don't get the 70s vibe to it, or the string section of the song.
Yeah.
I go, Dave's vocal tone is okay in parts. It just, I'm not digging this 1-2 punch,
it's at all. Horrible way to follow up Making a Fire. And then, like, the riff is so simple. Boom, 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 boom. Like, what is happening?
Yeah.
What are you doing? Thankfully, in my opinion, they pick it up with Cloud Spotter. This one's kind of a little more funky, a little more upbeat. I think that it's a palate cleanser for me with Shame Shame. This is one, again, like, now that I'm kind of understanding what this album is going for, I'm like, okay, I like this portion of what you're thinking for this album. If you keep going with this vibe, I'm going to be okay, because the chorus is great. I love the chorus of this one.
Yeah, this is, I wrote down, this is like a 70s Caterpillar. You have a woodblock spoken word into a modern day beautiful butterfly rocker. And once again, the female singers are throwing me off again.
Yeah.
But if you drop the female singers in this one, I think it has some good girth to it.
Yeah, for sure. Then we go to Waiting on a War, which I believe was the third single, the last single released right before the album came out. This is a builder. This is one of the ones that builds up. It has the kind of like plaintive beginning. Dave's vocals are great on it. I do love when the song kicks in towards the end. It just kind of takes a while to get there.
Yeah, it does. I like how it starts off a little softer. He has that acoustic sound to it. Dave's soft vocals turns into a lot heavier at the end. You know, I enjoy it. I kind of like when they do that. Like I said in a couple songs before, I like how they start off that slow and they build through the song and it gets to where it needs to be. I like when they do that.
Mm-hmm. Then we get to the title track, Medicine at Midnight. It's fine. it's pinned between two singles. So it kind of doesn't stick out to me, but I don't know. What do you think?
This is where, when you said that it's a very David Bowie influenced album.
Yeah.
This is that song. Dave's vocal sounds just like David Bowie. It has that David Bowie feel, the groove. It is just, and like I said, even Dave's vocals, he sounds very early Bowie.
Yeah.
You know? Do I go to the Foo Fighters for David Bowie? No, I go to David Bowie for David Bowie.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. Only David Bowie can be David Bowie, Dave Grohl.
Yeah, once again, like as you get deeper in this album, this album just turned into a big disappointment for me.
It's a shame.
It's a shame that they did this album.
Well, BB, I hope you enjoyed the next one, because No Son of Mine, they realized how shitty of a single Shame Shame was, so they released No Son of Mine as a single, and that was when I'm like, okay, if a song like this is on this album, I'm going to like it. And this is a great song. It's heavy. It's got that rocking. It's a weird cadence, but I think that it works. What'd you think of it?
Yeah, this is the standout song for me on this album. Definitely. It's a big rocker. This is the Foo you want to hear. Yeah. It has the big drum beat. You know, Dave's vocals are fantastic at that tone. Once again, this is No Son of Mine is the song you want to hear, and you know, you wish there was a little bit more of.
Yeah. Holding Poison, I think, is an okay follow-up to No Son of Mine. Kind of keeping that like heaviness a little bit for it. What'd you think of it?
Yeah, this is more of a like the mid-tempo rocker that they, you know, they're known for.
Yeah.
You know, nothing spectacular. You know, nothing really stuck out for me with this one. It's just, you know, the normal Foo Fighter rocker.
Yeah. And then Chasing Birds happens, and I'm like, guys, you're on such a good roll. What happened? Why? We're towards the end of the album. You don't want me to turn it off prematurely. It's okay. But this album, it's like I get so excited, and
you just can't grab it.
Yeah, What'd you think of Chasing Birds?
I don't know what it was about Chasing Birds. I don't know if it was the melody or how mellow it was, or the lyrics. You know, like, this is one of those songs, like, if you smoked weed, this would be you're sitting on the porch smoking weed, kind of just chasing birds.
Yeah,
you know, This is the what I got off of that one.
Yeah. And then ending with Love Dies Young, which was, I believe, the last single released. I think it's better than Chasing Birds.
Oh, man.
I dare say it's probably the best closing track of the night. Not that that's saying much, but at least they ended up with Chasing Birds.
Yeah, for sure. It has a nice little chugging beat in it. It has that Foo Fighter iconic guitar sound through it. It's upbeat, and like you said, I guess it could be the best ender of an album, because this poor album. Oy.
Yep.
This album, I once again, it's almost like they're just doing what they want, their influence, we're going to release what we want, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, it's not the first six Foo Fighter album.
No,
you know?
No. It definitely, it was a different route for them. I'm very sad that this is the last release with Taylor Hawkins. I don't feel like it showcased him as well as it could have. Unfortunately, I feel like Concrete and Gold showcased him a little better than this. You know, I don't even think that this was the best release, like, of their stuff that came out, you know, in between then and now, because, you know, they were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. They released Hail Satin, Bee Gees covers album, which was great. And then they released the Studio 666 album, the Dream Widow.
The Dream, EP. Yeah.
And those, I think, are so much better than the actual album they put out. And I'm like, guys, what are you doing?
Yeah.
And those two things got me so excited for what the band was going to do. And then, of course, Taylor passed away, unfortunately. And it kind of, like, they were on such a roll with, like, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, awesome Bee Gees covers, a movie, a really cool metal album. And then, you know, everything kind of had to stop short, unfortunately, because they lost such a key member of their band and somebody who's been with them since their third album. So I'm really excited that they are kind of picking up steam again, gaining momentum to make a comeback. I know that they'll honor Taylor with their, you know, whatever they do, because Taylor was Dave's best friend.
Yeah.
You know, they're not going to do something that's going to be sacrilegious to him. So I trust them. It's one of those situations where I'm glad that they are persevering, because if you think about it, Foo Fighters was created as an outlet for Dave to kind of get over Kurt's death, you know, Kurt Cobain's death, and create music for himself and as a healing process. So it's really cool that the band could do that again. And
right.
Help heal everybody, as well as, you know, just Dave. But I'm excited to hear the album.
Yeah, but you think about that, man. The shoes that Dave has to, you know, walk in. But man, from his singer to his drummer.
Yeah.
It's just, man, it's got to be tough.
Mm-hmm.
You know, trying to get yourself motivated to write songs and, you know, sing songs and have somebody else play the drums, and it's not your best friend. You know, it's got to be heartbreaking for Dave. And, you know, kudos to him to getting over that and, you know, hopefully releasing some killer stuff in the near future.
Yeah, it might be like an Avenged Sevenfold situation where they lost, you know, Jimmy the Rev Sullivan. And
right.
they managed to kind of come out, you know, strong and still honoring him. Because, like, I know when they play Afterlife, they'll have him on the screen doing the part right before the chorus that he sings on the album.
Mm.
They'll have him, doing that, like, video wise,
right,
which is a really cool way to honor him. So I'm sure that's something like that's going to happen with Taylor.
Yeah.
They even had Taylor's son come up to play. Yep. I think it was My Hero that he played drums for during the Taylor Hawkins tribute concert.
Right.
But yeah, it's kind of a disappointing leg of Foo Fighters' discography for me as a fan, because I'm more of a rocking Foo Fighters fan. I don't quite like when they branch out, and this is their branch out era for sure. If you had to rank the albums, BB, what would you rank the albums?
Definitely, I think I'm with you with the little EP of Saint Cecilia, number one for sure. Number two, I think I'm gonna go with Sonic Highways. You know, even though it was all over the place, I can't wait to actually watch the documentary. It kind of puts things in perspective of different areas and how things evolved in, you know, New Orleans and in Chicago and even New York City. So I'm excited to see that. Third, I go Concrete and Gold. You know, it had its shiny moments, you know, for sure. And then, but there are some different duds in there. And I'm sure, just like you, my last will be Medicine at Midnight. You know, that just didn't do anything for me.
Yeah, that's my order as well. Saint Cecilia, Sonic Highways, Concrete and Gold, and Medicine at Midnight. I think Saint Cecilia is such a good EP, and it's that vibe of Foo Fighters that I really just go to the band for. You know, the All My Life, Burning Bridges, Rope, that kind of Foo Fighters, and that EP has it in spades. Concrete and Gold, like you, or Sonic Highways. I mean, the first five tracks are fantastic, but then the back half is a little weak. Then Concrete and Gold, it does have its, like you said, it does have its high notes, but a lot of it is just kind of forgettable. And then Medicine at Midnight. I do like a lot of the songs at Medicine at Midnight, but it has Shame Shame on it, which is the worst fucking Foo Fighters song in my opinion. I hate that song so much. Why would you release
Dylan,
it as a
shame
single?
Shame on you.
Why would you release it as a single? That makes no sense to me. It makes zero sense to me. I'm baffled by that. I still am. And when I heard that song, I go, this might be the worst single I've ever heard in my life. And that's including the ABCDEFU song that came out. it's very disappointing. I like that they tried new things. I do. And I think that at times it worked, like with Cloud Spotter and No Son of Mine, like having those 70s disco pop influences coming into their rocking and marrying that. I think that that's when it works. The funk kind of feel to it. But some of the times it just doesn't, and I don't know, but I would recommend listeners listening to some of the songs that I'll put on the playlist. I'm not putting Shame Shame on there, I'm so sorry, but I'm also going to put on some songs from the Dream Widow EP and from Hail Satin, because I think that some of those are really cool. The cover of You Should Be Dancing is actually really good, from the Bee Gees. Dave does the, you know, the Gibb high vocals well. It's mind-blowing, but I think that they clearly had fun during this era, so I'm happy for that.
Yeah.
But I just wish they came out with a little better of an album. overall, like, what did you think of this era of the Foo Fighters compared to the rest of the eras that we covered?
Yeah, it's tough, and I don't know if it's, like, the lack of MTV or lack of...
That's a good...
It's, like... None of these songs were, like, big songs.
No.
And they released a lot of videos. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know, the lack of MTV, you know, you're not, people aren't watching videos on, like, YouTube like we used to watch videos. You know, nobody around here is playing Foo Fighters song on the radio.
Yeah.
So, I don't know if it's, is it just the time? Is it the... music, because these three albums are kind of all over the place, but it lacks that early, you know, first six albums that they were known for and fans were crazy for.
Yeah.
You know, and that was like a younger crowd. Like, I'm very confused of Medicine at Midnight going to that 70s groove, because even somebody like me, you know, being 50 years old, loved the Foo Fighters when they came out.
Mm-hmm.
I was never into the disco era.
Yeah.
So I'm very surprised of why they would go into that disco era when a lot of the fans that kind of clung to these guys were from the MTV days and all these videos. And, you know, and I was very confused of what the, you know, I understand, like, they were a big influence back in the day, but, you know, I'm very weird of what real, true, you know, crazy Foo Fighters fans thought about, you know, this last album, because in their catalog, they go, it's almost like they're getting worse as they get deeper, as they get older.
And you know what? You actually jogged my memory about something, BB, because if you look at a lot of the popular music that's been released in the last couple of years, you know, Bruno Mars doing stuff with Silk Sonic, Harry Styles, a lot of that is 70s inspired. Especially Harry Styles, you know, you do have that 70s inspired stuff. You know, Dua Lipa is kind of doing a little bit of that with the 80s. But, like, you are getting that kind of nostalgia-fueled, modern music where it is harkening back to an older age. So I don't know if they were trying to capture some of that, maybe.
Could be,
But, yeah, like, now that you mention it, I do think it is interesting thinking about, like, yeah, they're, like, big music videos, like, in the late 90s, early 2000s, you know, Learn to Fly and Everlong, and those, like, were big on MTV, yeah. And, like, now there's not really anything like that besides, you know, Vivo on YouTube or whatever. I think the last video that I could, like, remember the visuals for was The Pretender, like, where they're playing in, like, the Riot Cops.
The Riot Cops, yeah. It's, like, white and red. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, like, that's the last, I think, music video that I could remember from them, which is interesting.
Yeah.
And, you know, that might have been, like, the turning of the tide in, like, the late 2000s. But, yeah, I think that there is, it's one of those situations where we see with some bands where they're trying to be trendy, and it doesn't quite work. And it's weird to say that going for the 70s sound is trendy, because it's the 1970s that they're hearkening to. But there are a lot of musicians that are kind of like pulling 70s funk into their music and modernizing it with the pop tinge to it.
Right.
And I don't know if the Foos were going with that, or if that was something they were just genuinely interested in, and it kind of just coalesced at the same time, you know. Like that independent thought of, like, everybody was making a steam engine, but only one person made the patent for it. You know, that kind of thinking. Right. But I don't know. It's definitely one of my least favorite eras of the band, especially since they had such high points in their early, like, the last two episodes we did.
Right.
Like, they were on top of the world. And I think even with Sonic Highways, they were still on top of the world. But with Concrete and Gold, it started kind of... The staircase started falling down, right. I guess. But I don't know. It's interesting to see a de-evolution of sorts in our minds.
Right.
I don't know. It's
and sad. It's not like they didn't release any videos or anything, because look on Apple Music, they're,
yeah,
you know, there's like three or four for each of these albums.
Yeah, and they released a friggin' documentary for one of them. I mean, you know, it's really strange, because even though they're the most recent albums, I cannot remember how they promoted Concrete and Gold. And I know that they didn't promote Medicine at Midnight a lot because of COVID.
Right.
Did that maybe have something to do with it? Like, maybe it was one of those things where they let it sit too much and they kept tinkering with it, like, during COVID, where they're like, oh, maybe we should add this. But I don't know. That's just me speculating. Yeah. You know, it's not my favorite COVID album, I'll say.
Yes.
It's still better than Inspirations from Saxon, at least.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know if Sonny Pooney would agree with you there.
Oh, yeah. He's a big Saxon fan. You're right. I'm sorry, Sonny.
I saw the shirt.
Yeah. But everybody, thank you for listening. We hope that you found some enjoyment from these albums. I know that we definitely have some tracks that we're keying in, especially from Saint Cecilia. If you haven't checked that EP out, please do. It's some of the best Foo Fighters that I've heard, and especially some of the best modern Foo Fighters. It has some really good rock and stuff, and like BB said, it's got the Sick Bananas...
Short solo of the night.
7-second solo of the night. So hopefully you all have a great rest of the week, and we will talk to you next week with our next episode. Maybe the rest of the band will be back together. It'll definitely be back together before this episode.
Yeah.
So time is an illusion.
Yes, for sure.
But hope you enjoyed this episode. I know that I enjoyed talking with you, BB, about this.
Yes.
Always fun to talk about quote-unquote out-of-format stuff.
Cat's away, the mice will play.
Exactly. Yeah, when my dad's not around. Because he's not as big a Foo Fighters fan, and I do not think he would have liked these albums.
No, he would have bashed these to death.
He might have liked some of the stuff, but I don't think he would have liked Medicine at Midnight.
No.
But yeah, I hope you all enjoyed, and we will see you next time, and there definitely will be a next time.